Hey everyone, Victor Killer 3 Bravo Lima Jarrad here, and let's play a game of what's in the box and how well does it work. So I recently ordered a Chinese special, a Feeltech Fox Yankee 6600, which is actually a little 60 up to 60 megahertz signal generator. They call it a function generator, and indeed it can do a whole bunch of stuff. It is worth mentioning first up that it can only go up to 60 megahertz with a sine wave. I think the limit for a square wave is around 25 megahertz, but it's still incredibly impressive. For US viewers, you'll pick one of these up for less than $100. So it really is a great little bit of kit. And let's see how well it works. Let's do some basic testing. You can see I've got my trusty Siglent SDS1102CML oscilloscope there in the background. It's just running its square wave testing pattern, its calibration pattern. And we'll plug into channel 2 and we'll have a look. Anyway, what's in the box? You'll see I actually had to label the box because otherwise you wouldn't know what it was. So you open it up. A bit of view. Oh. And we have the unit. And it's all going to fall out, but that's okay. We have one very handy BNC to BNC adapter, which means I can plug it directly into the scope. That's going to be very useful in a second. We have a USB cable because the unit can actually be plugged into the computer for you to define your own arbitrary waveforms, which is pretty cool. Put that in the box. It comes, at least this one, with a VK power adapter converter. Not a big fan of these things, but the power lead itself, it's just your standard two prong. I think that's a US plug, but correct me if I'm wrong. But it's just a standard figure eight, so any old power lead will do. Let's undo that. And we'll plug that in. Well, at least it has a nice and tight fit. And you've also got, might as well undo them while I'm here. Well, it looks like two sets of, I'm doing a very good job at this, but anyway, excuse me, two sets of, I guess, signal injectors, which is another nice touch. That's great to have, very generous of them, and they look well made, unlike some of the cables you get from China, especially that kind of cable. And you get your Feeltech quality certificate, which no one bothered to fill out, but checker number one apparently checked it. Don't think they've quite got there with that process. Just your standard bubble wrap, bit of sticky tape at the back. Out comes the unit. Now, for some reason, the software is on one of these micro CDs. Good luck finding something to read that on these days. Even if you do find a CD-ROM, it might be a slot one. I'm sure we can get the software elsewhere. Put the bag away over here for the moment. And here's the unit itself. It is incredibly light. It does actually come with a screen protector. I have previously taken that off. The buttons are your sort of pressed, they're not, I forget the name of the buttons, but they're the sort of the membrane style buttons. Your knob has a click. The screen is actually quite nice. It comes in English, even though the some of the Chinese sellers have a picture of the Chinese screen. I did buy this from a local Australian seller and paid an extra $10, I think, to get it quickly, but it was worth it. You'll notice that the BNC jacks are not quite in the center. You know, it's got the little yellow surround there. It's not quite in the center. Who really cares? Flipping it around, you've got a bunch of cool things here. Synchronization in, sync out, VCO in, trigger FSK, ASK, and PSK in. So you can modulate your, but basically you can use it as a little radio if you want to. You won't get much power out, but you can use it as a, you can use it as an AM radio if you feel so inclined, as an AM transmitter, I should say. Don't know how it would sound. We might have to test that one day. You've got a power switch at the back here, and there's a USB port. There's TTL level logic out. Not sure what that's used for. Basically, this thing has so many features, it will probably take me quite some time to figure out what, as a ham radio operator, I want to do with it other than generate sine waves. So let's plug it in. Bear with me for a second. I'm going to do the delicate job of moving without hopefully knocking the camera. And the Australian power adapter went in first time, but the power cord is not very long. That's a bit of a fail. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. Oh, the unit's quite light. Oh, no, we can't do it. What can we do here? Now, there's a pro tip. Be very careful of your unit as it may get pulled off the bench by the power cord. Luckily, I can wedge this power cord into my trestle table and it's happy days. So let's have a look. Flick the switch on the back. Click, click, no one died. That's a good start. And I'll slide back in without hitting the camera. And let's, can we bring it forward much? No, we can't. But basically, I'll zoom in for 1 second. And you'll see there, hopefully, and we'll move it across a little bit, just bring it in. Hopefully you can see there that you've got your sine wave functions. Basically, you adjust everything at the top of the screen and your secondary channel is at the bottom. If you want to play with the secondary channel, you press the channel button and it will come up to the top. Now, in this case, I want to turn it off. So let's see if I can figure out how to do that. No. That's how you change the waveform, by the way, and you can use the knob for that. There we go, we just press the channel a second time and it will go off. So we'll go back to channel one, it's on. Why did I want to turn it off? I guess I'm just a little bit funny like that. So there you go. So you've got a few buttons, there's a few ways of doing things. You can change your waveform by pressing this, that takes you to here. You can then either keep pressing that or you can rotate the knob, and there is heaps of different waveforms built in. More than I will ever need, really. I just look, there's random noise, multi-tone, ECG, we can do a heartbeat, cool, good for medical shows. Impulse noise, all kinds of stuff, AM even, frequency modulation, chirping, lots of cool stuff. Unfortunately, I haven't found a quick way of going back to sine, so other than turning this knob around a lot. That's okay, I can't see mine going off sine much. Now, it does start out with an amplitude of 5 volts, and there's been a bit of, I guess, question on the net as to what that 5 volts, and we'll zoom out again, guys, what that 5 volts actually sort of is. When people put a T-connector on and put it into their scopes, often they find that its peak-to-peak is 2.5 volts, not 5. So let's see what it does with my Siglent here. And I've got a nice little lid to tell me channel 1's going. Now these BNC back cables are not the best in the world, but they're not the worst either. Let's move that across a little. And we'll pull up the Siglent. Now, I might just rotate the camera for you fellas, and any YLs that are watching. As you can see, I've got a square wave test zone running there. It's just on the first channel, and it's about 3 volts peak to peak, 1 kilohertz. Let's plug into channel 2. Excuse my hands. Turn channel 1 off for the moment. Go away menu. Surprised I still know how to work this thing. Let's turn channel 2 on, and we'll hit auto. Gotta love auto on these new scopes. Nope, let's turn channel 1 back on for me. I spoke too soon. Go away menu. Okay, so let's position this up a bit, and let's see what we've got. We'll change our time, and I really should change, if I can remember, I can't remember it yet, but how to do it now? I should change channel 2 to be the reference. Okay. Oh, I'm hopelessly lost. Let's get rid of channel 1 for the moment. As you can see, I haven't used the scope in years. What a bad amateur. Here we go. Let's bring that position down. So what have we got here? Okay, we'll change. No, that's that. We'll change that. So each division is 1 volt. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 volts. So there you go, it's plugged straight into a scope. It says the amplitude is 5 volts. And on our screen, we've got 5 volts here as well. You could see it's not quite as clean at 1 kilohertz as my scope's calibration, or probe calibration signal generator, but people who know more about test equipment can tell me whether that's a problem or I don't really think it is for my use. As I said, I like using, let's go back to it, a sine wave. But let's have a look at a square, because that's about the hardest thing you can generate, because Fourier transformations, guys, multiple sine waves stacked on top of each other via a DDS. So that's not what I want, horizontal. Let's have a look. Okay, so now we're really zoomed in. You can see there's a little bit of jitter there coming out of the generator, I believe. What are we at, 10 kilohertz? Sorry, not 1 kilohertz, my bad. Let's change that frequency. Well, you can use those left and right keys here, I think. No, that's back and forth. We'll make that a 0, make this a 1. And not much has changed. You can see there's a little bit of jitter there, but we're looking at intervals that are 5 nanoseconds. So that's pretty impressive. Basically, it's ramp time on a square wave at 1 kilohertz is 10 nanoseconds. So you'd have to be pretty happy with that for $100. And if we, sorry, that's a position. If we change back, you know, you can see that, well, even 100 nanoseconds is quite short, isn't it? 1 microsecond, you've got a nice ramp there. A little bit of an overshoot, but you know, that could be because of the quality of the coax, that sort of thing. It's, as I said, this isn't a calibrated cable. Guys who are more familiar with test equipment can tell me why there's a little bit of overhang there, but you've got your 5 volts per division. Now, they're said to be 50 ohm impedance output, I believe. Now, it looks like when you plug it into a scope, which is, I don't know what the scope's input impedance is, I'd have to look it up for the signal, Siglent. Basically, what I'm trying to say is, whatever your amplitude here is what you'll get on your scope. Now, if you have a load, I've seen people plug T-connectors into these with a 50 ohm terminator, and they've gotten half the amplitude. To me, that screamed, well, isn't the scope 50 ohm input impedance and isn't the other thing? And hey, that's normal, but someone can comment and tell me where I'm wrong there. Anyway, it doesn't really matter because I'm not that interested in how well calibrated this is, because I've got other things like this scope, and that's what I care about. You know, this is a nice, decent, proper calibrated, reasonably calibrated instrument, and that's what I care about, not so much this. This is just a good way of generating things very, very cheaply. And just to demonstrate, we'll go frequency, and I'll show you something someone else pointed out. The amplitude on one of the other units, so I'm just trying to see if I can capture it here. What's that saying? 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the amplitude isn't exactly linear. I suppose it probably is. Some people have reported that theirs haven't been completely linear, especially when you start getting down into the lower voltages or going beyond 6 volts. But that said, for the money, you're really getting a signal generator. You're not getting a calibrated instrument, and you've got to rely on something like this to be your calibrated instrument. So that's back to 5 volts. What I'm interested in is we'll actually go really low. What do we go? Let's see if my scope can even measure this and whether it's actually generating it. Well, my scope doesn't have the bandwidth, but that's 50 microvolts, which is apparently S9. Now, it doesn't look too good on the scope, I must admit. And it would be interesting to know what it actually sounded like, because I probably am not going to own a bit of test gear anytime soon that can go down to 50 microvolts. But hey, there's a bit of a sine wave. Let's see if we can turn it up a little bit more. So let's just say that we are faced with a situation whereby even at low output, this is 5 millivolts, we've got a noisy, jittery signal, and we want to use this device to, say, do some transceiver testing. Now, what do we do? Are we stuck? Are we not able to use the transceiver? No. The sensible thing is, once again, as I said, this isn't a calibrated instrument. Let's just set it back to, say, something sane, something that it's actually designed to produce stably. And give me a second. Set it back to something like 1 volt. Now, if we wanted to get down to 50 microvolts or something, a nice calibrated or known value attenuator would do the job nicely. So even though, this isn't a perfect $800 5 megahertz function generator. There's a reason why those things cost so much, and that's because they're calibrated. But that doesn't mean this can't be exceedingly useful for ham radio usage. You just need to know how to get the signal out of it that you want. And in this case, if I wanted 50 microvolts to go straight into the back of a transceiver to measure S9, I'd use an inline attenuator. And I've actually got a rotary attenuator and some attenuators, fixed value attenuators. I've got up there a 10 dB and a 20 dB. And I'm actually going to use this and this to figure out whether they are, 10 dB attenuators or not. So that's, the kind of interesting thing you can do. So much in engineering is the area under the graph. And by that I mean, what you care about is the value of the deviation, not the absolute measurement. Now, I'm not necessarily concerned, or neither is the other operator, whether your signal looks like this or this. We just care that it's above the noise. So don't, a lot of people get fixated with test equipment on getting really accurate gear, and that must be that exact value that's written on the screen. Now, that's fine if you're in engineering and you're doing stuff up into the gigahertz range, but if you're just playing around with ham radio, you don't need that level of accuracy, because most of the time what you'll be looking at is, do things vary the way I expect them to? And in this case, if I wanted to vary that waveform over 30 dB, I can use a rotary step attenuator, not a problem. So there you go. I think it's a really, really cool little bit of kit for the money. I'm hoping to use it to do some very interesting testing involving this guy here, the MFJ 1708 SDR, which is basically a little switch that lets you plug, say, an SDR play in between your transceiver and receive on that while your transceiver is operating. I think there's a bit of a design flaw with the MFJ 1708. In my opinion, it's nothing more than a switched T connector. Now, is that a problem? Well, some people say it is, because some receivers have different values of, and the people are trying to break in here, some receivers have different input impedances, especially across different frequencies. So I think it is a problem, but let's find out how much, and let's use this imprecise but very cheap instrument to do it. Anyway, I better say 73. The family's banging on the door. This is Jarrad VK3BL. Hope you enjoyed the video of the Feeltech FY6600. Very affordable, very feature-packed, but not quite lab-grade accurate function generator. Cheers!